The House Panel on Legislative Franchises set to investigate the Sunshine Media Network International, or SMNI, for allegedly spreading disinformation about Speaker Martin Romualdez. Quezon Province Representative David Suarez called for the probe, saying SMNI reported that Romualdez spent 1.8 billion pesos for his travels. The House was quick to deny the allegation as it demands a retraction and apology from the network. Suarez adds the House is also exploring other options to hold those accountable for the alleged smear campaign against the speaker.
Did they even care to validate? Did they even care to ask? Did they even care to find out what really is the truth with regards to this matter? At ito pong pinalabas ng SMNI, isa po itong fake news. Hindi po ito totoo.
SMNI's owner, Pastor Apollo Quiboloy, is a known ally of former President Rodrigo Duterte, who has recently been critical of the Congress. The House probe will begin Thursday, November 30. The Philippine Senate remains divided over the International Criminal Court's drug war probe. See, on Tuesday, opposition Senator Riza Ontiveros filed a resolution urging government to cooperate with the ICC's investigation. But this move did not sit well with her colleagues, Senator Aimee Marcos, and the drug war's architect, Senator Ronald De La Rosa.
Ikaw ba naniniwala na walang hustisya ang nangyayari sa Pilipinas? Oh. Tanungin ko siya. Huwag tayong magpastikan dito. Siya ang nag-file. Siya ang may motive. Masama ang loob ko. But I don't need to talk to her.
Talagang basag ulo to. So they're really looking for trouble. But President Duterte has said repeatedly, bring it on. Para sa akin, ang totoo, desisyon ito ng ehekutibo.
Over at the lower house, lawmakers will begin hearing the ICC resolutions filed by three groups of lawmakers. Vice President Sara Duterte, who was urged to join the hearings, responds to speculations the ICC issue is being resurfaced to attack her family.
Iwan na lang namin yan sa mga tao, no, na i-analyze. I do not want to speculate sa mga motives ng House of Representatives. Mga mahilig sa politika, magmasid sila. And hindi pa talaga kasi ngayon ang panahon ng pamumulitika dahil napakalayo pa ng 2025. And syempre, mas malayo pa ang 2028.
The Philippine government explores the resumption of peace talks with communist rebels. But while negotiations may restart after a six-year hiatus, government says there will be no ceasefire during the holidays. More from Pia Gutierrez.
The Philippine government and the National Democratic Front of the Philippines have agreed to a principled and peaceful resolution to end the armed conflict. This after both sides signed a consensus last November 23, paving the way for a fresh round of peace talks, which they hope to result in a final peace deal.
Resolving the roots of the armed conflict and ending the armed struggle shall pave the way for the transformation of the CPP, NPA, and DF. The parties acknowledge the deep-rooted socio-economic and political grievances and agree to come up with a framework that sets the priority for the peace negotiation with the aim of achieving the relevant socio-economic and political reforms towards a just and lasting peace.
The agreement comes following a series of informal discussions held in the Netherlands and Norway starting in 2022 between the Philippine government and the NDFP and facilitated by the Royal Norwegian government.
I believe nakita ko personally, there is that kind of commitment and also there is a kind of a goodwill on both parties to continue to discuss some principled resolution to end really the armed conflict. We are very confident, I'm very confident that there is something that after this joint statement, we can finally end up with the final peace agreement.
The NDFP meanwhile says it would negotiate for several conditions before it returns to the negotiating table. This includes the participation of detained NDFP consultants in negotiations, immunity for NDFP members who will participate in peace talks, release of all political prisoners, and the abrogation of their group's terrorist designation.
The assurance of safety and immunity for those involved in the peace negotiations will help facilitate the negotiations and create a favorable atmosphere. We will continue to seek effective measures to address these serious issues and concerns and create a conducive conditions necessary to achieve a just and lasting peace.
The government meanwhile clarified that the agreement will have no immediate effect as far as the government's security and law enforcement operations and programs are concerned, including the CPP-NPA-NDF's terrorist tag.
Sa ngayon po, ang ano po natin is kung ano po ang ginagawa ng gobyerno, patuloy po yung ano po natin, yung ating pong programa. So it is agreed upon that there is no immediate effect.
While Philippine Defense Chief Gilbert Chodorez says the talks are exploratory, the armed forces of the Philippines sees the decision by both sides to take another crack at peace negotiations as a personal victory for the AFP.
Well, for the armed forces of the Philippines, this is very good news for us, no? Because it is the soldier more than anybody else who wants lasting peace, no? Who wants this conflict to finally end.
Bronner says the end of the communist armed conflict will also allow the AFP to shift its focus to the country's external or territorial defense. The announcement comes shortly after President Marcos Jr. issued amnesty proclamations to members of the CPP-NPA-NDF and three other rebel groups. The country's over 5-decades-old communist insurgency is considered the longest in Asia and has resulted in the deaths of tens of thousands of Filipinos. In 2017, then-President Rodrigo Duterte terminated its peace negotiations with the NDF as he blamed the group's failure to show sincerity, saying that they continued to engage in hostilities against the government. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Senate approves the proposed 5.77 trillion peso national budget for 2024. This paves the way for a bilateral conference to reconcile the Senate's version with the House, which was approved back in September. The vote, 21 yes, 0 no, and 1 abstention from Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel.
I will not object anymore. I'll just make a manifestation of my continuing objection to the use of a presidential certification for the budget when I do not see any emergency or calamity right before us which will be addressed by the certifications.
Meanwhile, Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno said the President may sign the 2024 spending plan before leaving for Tokyo for the Japan-ASEAN Summit in mid-December. Diokno is also urging Marcos to certify as urgent several tax bills to help ensure financing of next year's budget.
We ask the President to act on the following requests. These are some tax measures, VAT on digital services, excise tax on single-use plastics. This is for climate change proposal. Ito namang VAT on digital services. This is based on fairness.
Let's get an update now on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Benison Estrella.
Good morning, Bettina, and all our viewers. As of now, we're not monitoring any low-pressure area or tropical cyclone in and out of the Philippine area of responsibility. We have the northeast monsoon still affecting northern Luzon, while the easterlies continues to affect southern Luzon and Visayas. For Batanes and Babuyan Islands, expect some cloudy skies with rains, whereas many areas such as mainland Cagayan will have cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms, as well as Isabela, Aurora, Bulacan, Rizal, Laguna, down to Quezon, Bicol Region, Eastern Visayas, Caraga, and Davao Region. For Metro Manila and the rest of the country today, partly cloudy to cloudy skies with some isolated rain showers or thunderstorms. There's also a gale warning over Batanes, northern coast of Cagayan, including Babuyan Islands, and Ilocos Norte. And that's the latest from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. This is Benison Estareja reporting.
Thank you very much for that update, Benison.